Hello, Channel Fireball YouTube. This is part two of our limited testing meeting series for Zendikar Rising. I'm Ethan Sachs, Lord Tupperer, joined by Mr. Metronome, aka Ben Wernie, and Corticals, aka Alex Nikolic. We're going to be diving into our second color here in blue, looking at all the commons. And there's a lot of good commons to talk about here, guys. So we'll start off right off the bat. Is this what the number one common in the set is for you guys?
Yeah, number one in blue, certainly. I don't think it's number one in this set for me anymore.
Do you have Royal?
I think I have Royal Eruption as number
yeah,
one.
Yeah, okay. It's close for me. I think they're both really close. The fact that I'm way higher on red than I used to be.
Like, yeah, you came in kind of cold on red.
Yeah. I thought red was the worst color, and then I played with it and played against it a lot, and I think it's like one of the better colors now, actually.
Yeah.
So that colored my evaluation of Royal Eruption. But I think that, I don't know, either one's close. You could tell me that Into the Royal is the best. You could tell me that Royal Eruption is the best common. I would not argue.
And then is Deadly Alliance third? Or are we going somewhere else?
I don't love that Deadly Alliance these days. I think it's a little bit clunky. A lot of times it's like, you know, on average, if we're thinking, you know, we like to think of the party cards as, on average, you get two... a discount of two on them, mm-hmm. right? Because you're likely to have two creature types on the battlefield. And if you think about that in your head, you're like, oh, three mana removal spell, that's pretty good. But you're never casting it on three. And some of the value of murder is that you can just snap off their two drop, right? And right. You can't do that with Deadly Alliance. Yeah. So, like, it's still a good card. I still like it. But I do think I take the first Feed the Swarm and the first Vanquish the Weak over my first Deadly Alliance. If I have to make that
interesting.
Pick.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay.
I am not that high on Feed the Swarm, so I gotta. Well, we're getting ahead of ourselves. We're gonna
talk. Yeah, for sure. We're talking about blue cards here.
Okay. All right. So Into the Royal, I think definitely best blue common.
Yeah, for sure.
And I do
feel pretty strongly about Bubble Snare too.
I think so.
And yeah. Do you want to talk about Bubble Snare versus Into the Royal just quick, because I think that might raise
sure.
some eyebrows potentially.
Yeah.
Yeah. I just think that you know, Bubble Snare is great, right? This is probably one of the best enchantment blue versions of the spell we've seen. But I think that just the flexibility of Into the Royal, being able to bounce your own stuff, or you know, just curving out Risen Riptide, like two drop Risen Riptide into the Royal is game over a lot of the time. Just you know, obviously you draw a card on this one and you don't draw a card in Bubble Snare. I think that, I don't know, they're close, and I don't think it's too wrong to take Bubble Snare over Into the Royal, but I think just the added flexibility of all the things that Into the Royal does, I think just is that notch above.
Yeah. I think there's a pretty clear gap there for me. I mean, instant speed also, triggering spells matters.
Yeah.
Into the Royal does a lot of things that Bubble Snare doesn't.
Yeah, I'm with you. Like, it also saving your own stuff or rebuying your own stuff. It's just the flexibility of that card is pretty wild.
Bubble Snare for one mana, though, has been crazy impressive.
Very good.
Especially in Best of One.
Yes. Yeah. Huge tempo plays. So I think 1, 2, 3 here.
I kind of want to make a case for Tazim Royal Mage 3 over Risen Riptide.
Interesting.
Plead your case, sir, but...
yeah. Give us your case first.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think when you're in the kicker deck, Risen Riptide is absurd. But Risen Riptide is not premium when you end up with like 6 or 7 kicker spells. And I think that's the much more average case than it is to end up with like 10 plus kicker spells, where Risen Riptide really starts to be one of the best blue commons. And I think enough people are fighting over blue at the moment that you can't reliably get... If you're picking Risen Riptides aggressively, I think other people are taking the blue kicker cards aggressively, and it's difficult to get there consistently on a deck where Risen Riptide is great. Whereas Tazim Royal Mage, I think, is key in blue-white. I think it's the single best card you can have at common in the blue-white party deck where you're trying to rebuy your spoils or whatever it's called, the gold blue-white uncommon. I think it's excellent in blue-black because you're buying back premium black removal spells. It's obviously great in blue-green kicker, and also as a wizard for blue-red, and you can rebuy Into the Royals and Royal Eruptions. So I think I've got Royal Mage 3 over Risen Riptide.
They're like they're in the same tier.
I like your argument.
Day one Risen Riptides were much better than my day 7 or day 6 Risen Riptides, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I was triggering those things a lot on day 1 and day 2 of the format. I totally agree with Ben.
I also think that this card, like, when you are not in the situation where you're playing the tempo beatdown game, unless you've got into the Royal, it's very hard to trigger this on blocks. So like this being an 05 blocker, like I found myself being like, oh, I really wish I could pass with mana up to do something, but I have to bubble snare their creature now, but then I still won't get to block with this as a 5/5, you know? I have found that to be a slight downside.
Right. And I think it's honestly like they're both close enough and they do enough good things in the deck. Like there's decks where Riptide's gonna be better, there's decks where Royal Mage is gonna be better. But I guess your argument is there's more decks where Royal Mage is gonna be better.
I think there's more decks where Royal Mage is better. I think Risen Riptide's ceiling is higher than Royal Mage's.
Yeah.
I think Royal Mage is more consistently what you want in most decks.
Right. So. Risen Riptide can be an 8, but is often a 6 for Royal Mages. So it was a 7.
You can just cut, like, it's hard to imagine cutting Royal Mages, but I've definitely cut Riptides.
Right. Okay, I can buy that. Yeah. I mean, this is the great part about this discussion, right? But just, like, the evolution of the format, like, changing our evaluations. Because in my head, I'd always had Riptide as 3, but, and Kazim's been close, so I can buy Kazim as number 3.
Okay, so then beyond that, I would say Geyser Mage
next, I think. And I've got Stalker a little lower than that.
Okay. What's next?
I think it honestly might be Field Research.
So this is the card I want to talk to you guys about. Because,
yeah, of course.
So Max Mick, who is one of the trophy leaders on MTGO, he released a YouTube video where he like talked through his strategy and his thoughts about the cards. And you know, he was gushing over blue like we all have been. But Field Research stuck out. He thought that this card was really, really good. And so far for me, I've been unimpressed by just raw card draw in the format, like Field Research, like Spoils of Adventure. I just feel like with the modal double face cards floating around, with things like Into the Royal or, you know, Kicker getting you multiple things of value that add up to multiple cards, whatever, like that just random card draw has not been something that I have found wanting in my decks. So what's going on with this card for you guys?
I have liked the card advantage as far as continuing to allow you to hit your land drops when you need to hit land drops. And I think there are a lot of games that come down to an attrition battle. And yes, everybody's loaded with more ammunition because of the modal double face cards, but still drawing 3 cards, when you top deck this and you draw 3 cards, a lot of times the game is over. And the ability to cast it early as Divination and then buy it back later with Royal Mage to draw 3 late in the game can shut the door on some games. It has Kicker synergy. I think it just does a lot of small things really well. It triggers all your wizards caring about instants and sorceries while gassing you up for more of those cards, like the Relic Amulet and things like that. Plays really well with that. I just have liked it quite a bit in every blue deck, I think.
Yeah, okay. I almost think that modal double face cards are an argument for this card, right? Because you don't mind drawing into a land or a spell, right? Because so many of your lands are just spell action cards, right? But there's the opportunity cost, of course, of just like putting a card that doesn't affect the board.
Yeah, that's the sticking point for me. I just don't know when I have time for this.
I think the format has sped up. So I went from thinking this was like a medium slow format in the first few days of the format to I now think it's like medium and can very easily go either way depending on the matchup. And so I have found less time to cast my Field Researches now that people know how to build the decks more streamlined and people know what's up. But at the same time, it's weird because I am not a person who loves Divination as a limited Magic card, but this card still appeals to me. And I think it's what Ben was saying. Like, it's just all the small little things that add up on the card to make it good. Like the Kicker synergies, the spell synergies. Like, I almost think it's like less the drawing two, the more that it's just glue to a lot of the decks.
Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, I'm. It sounds like I've got the wrong idea about this card, so I'm going to move it up. As you can see, it's one of the only blue commons I don't actually have a copy of here.
wow, that's
yeah. So okay, because I think I would take Stalker over it. I would take Diviner over it. I'm just not. I'm not happy about this card that much, but I
would put Diviner in the same tier as Geyser Mage and Research. I mean, I'm taking Geyser Mage over Diviner, but I think it's about on power.
Yeah,
I have been pretty underwhelmed with Diviner myself.
Really? I've been really impressed with the card, like more than I thought it would be. Like, I like it over Stalker almost certainly.
I don't. I like, I take Stalker over Diviner.
I think they're all, like, I think all 4 of these are close. Like, I often have to choose between these 4.
Right.
And it's tricky, right? Yeah. So, yeah.
So then there's kind of a, there's a pretty steep drop. We gotta talk about your one drops here. You guys love this card.
Let's talk about this card, but there's another card I want to talk about. So
okay. I think you want to talk about the squid, and I want to talk about the squid.
Oh, I like the squid.
All right, let's talk about squid.
Yeah.
Squid's been good.
Squid's good.
Squid has been much, much better than I anticipated. So just being able to trade off with any of the two drops, any of the three drops is great. But also in like your blue black tempo decks or like your red blue tempo decks, just this attacking for three on turn, starting on turn turn three is great. And because you have so many, like there's the situation, I think when we first looked at this card where it's like, oh, you know, it's not going to attack sometimes when you really want it to. But you have so many lands in your deck if you're taking the double face cards highly that this attacks well into the late game, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I do think that this is just like a solid card. It's a step below these other, you know, seven or eight blue commons, but that's just because blue is so deep. But this is like a C. Like I'm totally happy to have this card in my deck.
Well, and as you
think you're happy playing it when your draft has not gone ideally. Yeah. Like you're talking about red blue tempo, black blue tempo, like when you're not in rogues or when you're not in wizards, like when you're more modal double faced cards and you're not caring about types as much.
Yes.
But if you don't get like the nut synergy deck, I'm like, all right, this is a fine pickup at the end of the pack, right? Maybe my intonation sounds like I'm more excited about this card than I actually am, but it's like I'm excited about it compared to how I thought it would play out, right?
I think we all had it pegged in like the D plus
unplayable
territory.
yeah and it's not there,
and it's not there. I think it's one of those cards where, especially where it's going right now in terms of like wheeling quite a bit, that's good for you,
right?
But I think I agree with Ben's assessment of you're happy with the card when your deck isn't like a nuts version of one of the better decks.
Yep.
Okay. So then what about Duelist?
I like Duelist over Squid. Yeah.
You like it over Squid.
I think that I don't know, maybe you two have had different experiences, but I think this is, I mean, it's best in blue black, obviously. But I think it's mostly just a blue-black card. It's very good there, though, right? Because you want to be kind of tricksy in a lot of your blue-black decks. The negative two helps with, like, you know, you have Death Touch creatures lying around in blue-black.
Mm-hmm.
I found this card to be pretty annoying to play against and pretty happy when I have it in my hand.
I have found it also to be good in blue-red decks with a lot of Grotag bug catchers where you're not, right, where you're blue-red tempo party, but you're not blue-red wizards, like where you want the seafloor stalkers to close out the game and you're trying to play a tempo game and make your Grotag bug catchers bigger.
Yeah. And it just eats excellence sometimes, right? Like they attack their 2/1 in and or whatever and you just eat it.
And sometimes it blows out a rabbit bite. It does so much.
Yeah, for one man, it does a lot of really little nice.
All right. I'll give this little guy a second chance. Then what else? Then there's not much.
I would put Seer down a tier from Grasp and Tempest.
Sure.
Yeah.
I would put Chilling Trap up in the Duelist Squid.
Oh, yeah. Let's talk about Chilling Trap.
I mean, this is very, very situation. Yeah. I mean, it's good when you've got, when you can reliably draw a card off of this, this card is great.
Yeah, it's quite good.
Yeah.
I'm happy playing one or two copies in a Wizards deck.
Yeah.
Then past that, like even Living Tempest, like it's not a great card, but I've also not been super upset when it has to make my deck, you know?
Well, the fact it just plays so well. When Into the Royal is your best blue common, it just plays very well. Right. Like it's totally fine to pass with five mana up when you could either interact with your opponent like this or with the Tempest, you know?
Yeah, exactly. It's totally fine. It's just never high priority. Glacial Grasp, same thing. I think it's like mostly a blue-black, blue-red card. You'll play one, but you're never like sad if you don't pick one up during the draft.
I agree. And then, you know, I think... let's talk about Anti-Cognition.
Yeah, let's talk about that.
So, my experience, I think, is that this is fine in blue-black and bad everywhere else.
And I think even in blue-black, like, you do have to work a little bit to make... like. Its ceiling is decent, right? But its floor is still pretty darn bad.
Go ahead.
No. You go ahead. If you want to argue
this. My feeling is that I don't think the floor is... In blue-black specifically, I do not think the floor is that bad. Because between, like, turns 2 and 5, when... like, this is essentially Essence Scatter.
Mm-hmm.
And probably... like, there may be this, like, small window where this doesn't counter the thing you want.
Yeah.
But you're gonna get them to 8 cards in that deck.
You are. My argument has always been, whenever anybody asks me about it, is just like, I feel like I rather just like another, you know, a Mnemonic Sky Dancer, like another yes. like random flyer or whatever. Like I always just would rather have something else than this in the slot.
You would be hard pressed for me to want to run this over an actual factual rogue in that deck. But I'm just saying, exactly. I think in that deck it's gonna get the card 9 out of 10 times. Now, is that that's not like a ringing endorsement for the card?
It's the same. I think it's the exact same argument as like us, you know, before we said, you know, disenchant. You can put disenchant in your deck. Does it raise the win percentage of your deck? Maybe, but maybe not, right? It's nothing. It's I'm not drawn towards the card.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think
Go ahead.
I was just gonna say that
you mentioned that Max Mix video, and he was saying, you know, just play any 2-drop to trade off with the aggressive deck's 2-drops. And he was like, even Cleric of Chilling Depths is good. I'm like, well, I guess that's so, like, that sells it. Blue's just amazing. Every single blue common is great, you know? Like, Cleric is not a great card, but you can play it. It's the same thing.
I guess so, yeah.
I think I'm playing Squid over Cleric in
every blue deck.
Yeah. I can't imagine where I would want this. Yeah.
It's fine. Like, if you need a 2, it is totally serviceable, but it's the same thing. You're never...
Is it totally serviceable?
I think it's quite
unserviceable to me.
Just out of service?
Yeah.
I think it's been fine for me. Like, I don't know. I don't think it's worth splitting hairs over, but, like, you put this in your deck, and you're not... Maybe you're a little embarrassed, but you're not... Your face isn't red, you know?
Yeah. All right. Shell Shield...
I think belongs up in the Grasp Tempest category. Yeah,
I've been, you know, especially when we'll get to talk gushing about Roost of Drakes in a second, but especially in those kicker decks, like when you have whatever, even 3 payoffs for kicker, I just think like getting that critical mass is nice. And this is, I think I have run this more in that situation than I have in the, I have got a key card I need to protect situation.
Yep. I agree. It's also just like, the amount of times that I've cast it for 1 mana and just like won a combat or blown out a removal spell, like a damage based removal spell, it's also been really good.
Yeah. And then I deliberate is whatever. You can run it in a Wizards deck if you need more stuff to trigger, but hopefully you're not playing this.
It's so much worse than it normally would be because of the double face cards, right? Like you just have card selection is at an all time low, I think, in this format.
Sure. So that's a big distinction to make between field research and deliberate. The fact that this actually nets you a card is more important than just raw card quality, which you in theory already have.
Yeah, exactly. And like you just, because so many of your cards are modal, the digging aspect gets much worse.
Yeah. And negate strict sideboard, and even at that, I'm not sure how often you're bringing this in.
Yeah, there's not even that many things that like rare wise, like most of the bomb rares are creatures, like there's like Felidar Retreat.
Felidar Retreat has been obnoxious. I brought it against that.
Yeah.
Yeah, but like aside from that, there's not too many like spell-based bombs, really.
Yeah, that's fair. All right, we like this ordering of blue here.
Mm-hmm.
Sweet. So it begins. With
the gushing? I'll gush about this card. This card's like an A-. This card's absurd.
It is,
it's
right?
It's wild.
Do we all agree on A- on this card?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's great.
You're taking it over most rares, or the average rare, rather.
I think I'm taking it over everything but, like, I don't know, 12, 13, 14 rares in the set. Like, you could give me, like, a handful of rares, I'll take over it, but...
Yeah, but we'll get there when we rank the rares. I'm excited to see where it goes.
Yeah,
it's going to be the Ben Slayer Angel of the set.
Yeah.
I think most people have caught on to this card, that it's absurd and busted. But, yeah, it's just... fantastic. There's just so, like, you end up with so many kicker cards in your deck incidentally, and the great thing about this is that, you know, you can end up with, you know, if you have 3 kicker cards in your deck, 3 other kicker cards, you know, it's not going to be amazing, but it's still good. It's still going to make you 2 drakes over the course of the game a lot of times, and like the floor of 4 mana 2/2 flyer is not the end of the world, you know.
Yeah, this card is wildly good. Why is it free? Why couldn't it just say pay 1 or pay 2? Yeah.
Free would even be more balanced if it didn't come with a Drake attached to it.
Right, yeah. If you couldn't kick it.
If
on
you couldn't
its own.
Kick it and make it 2/2, yeah.
Yeah.
Or if it costs 5 instead of, I don't know. I don't know what could have happened, but it's not this. So good. So then beyond that, where what's I'm curious to see where the MDFCs line up for you guys versus the rest.
I think for me, it's Amara Wizard next, and then there's a gap. And then I think I have Solundi Vision and Jawari Disruption.
Go ahead, sorry.
And then I think I'd be on Falconer, Domination, and then Baying Veil.
So you're like here, Falconer, Domination. I think I really like Wind Rider Wizard. So like something like that is what you're saying?
Something like that is where I'm at, yeah.
Alex, how about you?
Yeah, so I like Jawari Disruption and Baying Veil a lot, actually. I like, you know, I think you guys were talking this week how you guys think that Baying Veil is like one of the lesser ones. I kind of fall on the opposite side of that. Okay. I think it's better than Solundi Vision. Like, Solundi Vision's good, too. All these ones are good. But I've just found, like, you know, when Solundi Vision is the middle of the road one, right? It's the higher floor, higher floor, lower ceiling. Whereas when Baying Veil is great, it's game winning. When Solundi Vision, when Jawari Disruption is great, it's very, very good. It's a great tempo play. And Jawari Disruption in general, I found this card to be, you know, again, it looks like one of them that's only good early, but because people are casting, they're kicking their spells, they're casting six drops, like this is relevant to turn 5, 6, 7 of the game, right? Mm-hmm. I've gotten a lot of people just double spelling, you know, playing my three drop, holding this up, getting their five drop, right? So I have my order for the MDFCs, Passumara Wizard would be Disruption, Vision, Veil, I think, and they're all close for me.
I'm totally down for moving Veil ahead of those other uncommons.
Okay.
So you'd put Veil, so something like this.
I would put Vision swapped with Disruption, but you know, I don't think it matters too much. Like
I think we all agree Disruption is the best of these three.
Okay. Yeah. That's fair.
Yeah. It's so funny. Like, I think I'm really high on the MDFCs, and So here's something that I'm trying to do, and this may end up being outdated as soon as a few days from now, this thought. But I am trying to calibrate to the rest of the world a little bit.
Right.
And move these, the ones that I feel, you know, the ones we outlined on the show this week, the ones that I feel like very confident are the best uncommons, like Umara Wizard, like Black Bloom Rogue. I'm like, look, I'm just going to take those.
Yes.
The rest, like these, I'm trying to move down just slightly until people start to calibrate a little bit. I think I'm trying to stop going, oh, I'm gonna like get into blue for these. Whereas I think something like this or this or this pulls me into blue a little bit more than these three do here, even though these are more powerful, more flexible, whatever.
Yeah, it's tricky. I've taken the approach of just taking them early, and then like take them early, hope to play them, but at the same time, don't see them as signals when you get them sixth or whatever. Like, that's been my approach to it. And I've done, so yesterday and today, a few days ago, I was on the approach of just take every single MDFC you possibly can. And I was doing pretty well. Mind you, I was doing well because it's probably the beginning of the format and everybody's also still catching up to speed. But then I did what you were suggesting, like move them down a little bit in my pick order. And I noticed such a huge difference in my decks. Like they just felt much, much worse when I only ended up with two or three of them in my pile. And then when I just said again, I'm just going to take everyone I see and then make it work after that, my decks went, they just skyrocketed in power level again. So I think, I don't know, like you said, I'm still also calibrating to where everybody else is and how high exactly you should be taking them over cards like, you know, Falconer and Domination. But right now, I'm on the train of just take them. Don't see them as signals if you get them absurdly late, but just take them and they'll make your deck better.
So here's a question. Where does Into the Royal stack up in the mix for you here? Because I think I'm taking Into the Royal over that next stack of uncommons. And I think a lot of times it's close with these modal double face cards for me later in the draft, when I value the spell synergy or value the kicker synergy.
Well, we had this, someone tweeted us today, and we sort of touched on this on the episode this week of like pack one, pick one, Roost of Drakes, pack one, pick two, Wizard versus Into the Royal. What do you do?
It's tough. I think pick two, I think you take Amara Wizard still.
And why?
I don't know. It's really close.
Yeah. The more and more I've played, the more I feel like it's into the Royal.
That's where I'm leaning now too, yeah. Is that it's into the Royal.
Go ahead. Yeah.
No, it's hard to explain. It's just like this gut feeling I have right now.
Yeah, it's hard to reconcile exactly why. And I think it's just off the back of Into the Royal being so absurdly good. Right. I think that's really what it is.
And
it's
you wanting to enable this so very much.
Right. And it's not that Umar Wizard or Droid Disruption or any of these NBFC's cards are like lesser. It's that Into the Royal is great in the format. It's just fantastic, right?
Yeah.
But yeah, that's another super interesting line to try to draw.
And I think for me right now, I am pack one, pick one-ing Into the Royal over these three.
I agree with that. Yeah. Yeah. I think so too. I think Into the Royal is the only common I would take over a good MDFC.
So far,
mm-hmm.
There hasn't been much of a distinction of good and MDFC, right? So far, you guys have these just like...
Right, it's just MDFC. It's just in MDFC. General, right?
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. And it's hard because you're never going to have to pick between Umar Wizard and Droid Disruption or whatever, correct. Right? So, yeah.
Yeah. So I think
the Royal being ahead of Falconer, Lull Mage's Domination, Windrider Wizard, I think was probably counterintuitive to a lot of people as well.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, I think so too.
Yeah, it's close.
Yeah, I would take Into the Royal over all of these cards. It's very close though.
But that's just
Domination when you can cast it consistently is absurd. But it is a fairly significant cost to your mana base and your deck building. And if people in your pot are appropriately valuing blue, it's difficult to be blue enough to where Lull Mage's Domination is consistently great. But when it's good, it is.
Yeah, but I will say what I thought was that you would really want, like, that this would be tough without the cost reduction, and it's just not.
Right. I found the bottleneck on this card is the triple blue, not the X a lot of the time, right? That's the problem.
Yeah.
It's still great, though. It is still great. So if we're putting, let's just say, we put Into the Royal somewhere around the Umar Wizard range. Let's rank these next ones. I think Lull Mage's Domination is number one for me. Just the fact that you can get it back with Tazim, Royal Mage, you can start looping it. Like, it is pretty game breaking a lot of the time when you cast it, and even when you don't have the reduction, like you were saying, it's pretty darn good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I'd go. I would go in this order: Falconer next, then
me too.
Windrider Wizard.
Ruin Crab. Let's talk about that one. I think I have Rune Crab above both Wizard and Falconer.
Wow.
What?
I thought you guys would be on board with that automatically.
I'm definitely on board with it. Ben's not on board with it.
Oh wow. Yeah, no, I think it's absurd. I think this card, when you play it on turn one, it is a must answer card. And when you play it on turn four, it's still pretty close to a must answer card, especially when you have a bunch of card draw. You have a higher than normal amount of lands in your deck because of the MDFCs. You have card draw to hit your land drops. There's some decks can't interact with this card. They cannot get it off. Like, blue-white cries at this card on turn one, right?
Blue-white cries a lot in this format.
Yeah, blue-white cries a lot. That is true. I just think this card is great. And it's not even, like, I was approaching this at first as, oh, this is like a blue-black card to turn on your rogue things. I don't even think it's particularly great in blue-black. Not that much better in blue-black than it is in, like, blue-red or blue-green, for example, because I think the rogues mill them. They get to 8 on their own, right? This is just a win condition card that's great in any deck, and in blue-green especially, I think the home for it, the absolute best place, is blue-green, because that's the place you're going to be hitting your land drops most often, getting access to more lands, but it's just an any deck card, and it's good.
And so are you playing it as a one of in a deck that is not focused on milling your opponent out any more than that?
Ben has asked me this question 3 times so far, verbatim. And every time I say yes. Around that.
So, okay. Imagine it's just this, Ben. It's just, forget about any other mill. Like, just think of it this way. This is the way I'm thinking about it. You play on turn one and it will kill them. If it goes untouched, right? Over the course of a normal game, even in like a fairly aggressive game, it will kill them quicker than they can kill you if it goes untouched, right? If you hit your land drops. So if at very worst, it just says get rid of a removal spell out of their hand, that's not bad for a one mana spell and them spending their mana, right? But then the times when they don't remove it, or you recur it, or you can bounce it with Into the Royal to replay it, it's game winning.
Okay, I will trust you guys. I have not seen it on the battlefield yet.
Right.
In any game.
I've had it on my side and the opponent's side. And it's been, I've heard it described as oppressive. I don't think it's quite oppressive, but it's you know, I think it's very good.
All right, it's moving up a tier. Moving on up.
Okay, so where is Crab versus, like, say, Bubble Snare? You taking Crab over Bubble Snare?
Yes, I would take Crab over Bubble Snare. I wouldn't take it over Into the Roll Up, but I would take it over Bubble Snare.
That's silence, though. The wheels are turning.
You wanted arguments, Ethan. You got arguments.
This is great. But everyone's being so civil to each other. It's something, you know?
Well, because we all agree that white sucks. So here we go. Yeah,
exactly. I like Surefooted Infiltrator a lot. This is more about, I think, blue uncommons just being great than this card not being good. This is a pull into rogues for me.
That card feels clunky to me.
Yeah, it's been clunk city for me. I have wanted to like it. Yeah, I found it being awkward. It's one of those cards, almost like the red version. There's a red version, red rogue.
The Grotag Night Runner,
where it's great against an opponent who stumbles. Like, it feels amazing when your opponent has missed the land drop, or you have an Into the Roll or whatever. It's great there, but I think if you're on even footing with your opponent and they're keeping pace, it's a bit too clunky, right? You have to tap your own creature for it to get in. It's a small body, and then even still, when you go through the mini game of getting it in, it's like you draw a card, great, but they could be just beating you down with a Baloth or something. Like, I found this to be good, but it's not a pull for me.
It's a C plus for me, maybe.
You're right? Yeah,
bordering on C.
Yeah, I think I have it just at C actually.
Huh. Oh, all right. Maybe I'm too high on it. I've not experienced the cases you're describing, and comparing it, I really think that 2/3 rogue in red is bad. And so comparing it to that feels bad to me, because I think this is much better than that. But
it is. I agree. It is better than that card, because that card is not very good. Like you said,
the card is terrible. Yeah.
Yeah. I just think that even still, like, you know, you add a mana onto that card, gets a little bit better, but not too much.
All right.
Like, I would have Windrobber ahead of the Infiltrator, for
example. Me too. I think that is a better card in Rogues.
Okay. Yeah, I can get down with that. I think Windrobber in Rogues is good. I don't like this card. I don't like raw card draw. Are you guys into this card?
No, I agree. That card's bad. But Field Research is much better.
Because
than
it's flexible. Yes. And it has kicker. Flexible. I agree. I see the difference.
Yeah.
And I think this is just stone unplayable.
Yeah.
I've lost to it already.
Oh, of I mean, course
that
you doesn't
have, surprise
Ben.
Me. Yeah.
Yeah. So I think that, you know, I think something to think about, especially with Skyclave Plunder, is the whole, you know, you read this card, it reads as powerful, but it's just inflexible, right? Like, even you can have blue-black control decks in this format. I've had a good blue-black control deck where you're not particularly, you know, rogue-centric,
mm-hmm.
And you do just want a big card draw spell to gas up again, but it's not, it's even there, it's not a high priority, right?
Yeah.
You can read this card and it does read powerful, right? We've seen this effect on rares before, right? Just like 5 mana, draw 3 cards. But I think you just have to compare it to how good is it next to Merfolk Falconer or just a good creature. And I think raw card draw has just plummeted in value as the average creature has gone up in value over the years.
Yeah.
So here's a question before we move on.
Mm-hmm.
So the Lull Mage's domination tier, mm-hmm. are there situations where you're taking Domination, Falconer, Wizard, Ruin Crab over those three modal double-faced cards, and when are those situations? Like, if you're in the Nuts Wizards deck, are you taking Windrider Wizard over those cards? Are you taking Ruin Crab over them ever?
It's really tough. And this is what's so great about this set. So many of these questions are so contextual, right? And it's just like there's so many things that, you know, I don't know if we'll ever know the exact correct answer to. And I think the way you guys described it on the podcast this week was great. Just like, you're going to make, you know, the MDFCs are your power picks. Those other things are your synergy picks. And, you know, if you're in the middle of the draft, I think you really just have to critically think and ask yourself, like, how important is the synergy piece here? How likely am I to pick up a, you know, another good synergy piece later down the line based on what's open? And if you are likely to pick up more synergy pieces, or you have great synergy pieces, I'm just taking the synergy piece for sure. But if
so, there are situations where you're taking those cards over middle double-faced
cards. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, pick I think one, that to me is the most interesting part of the format.
Yeah,
pick one, pack one. I'm taking the double-faced cards because I want to ensure a density. I want to secure a density in my deck of them, right? I want to have 3, 4, 5 if I can, you know. But later on,
I 4 to 6 range has felt the best to me.
Me too. The thing I've thought about is just like, you take them early. You take them early because they make any deck, a 7 out of 10 deck, quite good. Makes them more consistent. But if you already have those synergy pieces and you just want more synergy to build on top of it, you don't need the random, you know, power booster. You just want the multiplier, basically, right? The synergy pieces are multipliers. I think the MBSCs are additive almost.
And so there comes a point when you have, you know, two Roost of Drakes or a Roost of Drakes and a couple of Iron Geckos that you're taking Bubble Snare over those metal double face cards, for
yes.
example.
Right. Yes.
Yep. And finding where you're at that point in the draft is very important.
Right. And I think this, somebody in my Twitch chat was saying this earlier, but I thought it was really true, is that a lot of previous draft formats have been very like pattern based in the fact that like, oh, I have this card. I want to take this card. Like I know the pattern that a previous draft, a draft like that has followed. But I think in these drafts, every single pick, you really have to critically think and like kind of go galaxy brain moment for a minute and be like, what are my next 4, 5, 6 picks potentially going to look like? And like, how does this card go with my previous pick? It's really not like, I don't know. I just don't think drafts follow a scripted lane as often as they did in some other formats. They're really going to be different based on your pile and what you expect to see later.
And you also have to take into account that idea of like, what do you, even as early as like early in pack one, what do I envision this deck looking like? Am I feeling like I'm going down a tribal route, a party route, a kicker route? Like, I think the less muddy that is, or maybe it is a little muddy and you're like, well, I feel like I'm doing, maybe it's in the middle of pack two and you feel like you're doing two things. All of that is going to influence it as well. But you have to be asking yourself those questions basically every single pick.
Every single pick. Yeah. And that's what's so tough about this format. And it's great. It's really great.
Well, the other thing that's awkward while we're on this discussion before we move on is there is a little bit of tension between, for example, taking a Jawari Disruption and shipping along a Risen Riptide or an Into the Royal.
Yes.
When you expect to get into kicker synergies. Like the idea that like it is sort of a tribal format and then you're sending tribal signals downwind of you to take a raw power pick. There's some tension there too.
Especially with blue, right? Because there's so many, a lot of times there's so many good blue cards in the pack and you're like, wow, this is wild because I'm not going to get many of these cards in the wheel.
Yeah, but well, the flip side is the blue is so deep that I think you can't like, you know, it can support three drafters at the table or whatever.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. We can stop gushing.
That's good.